Thank you very much indeed. Thank you and good evening. If occasionally you indulge in a little bit of hero worship, and I must admit I do, then tonight's programme is tailor-made to suit your needs. Our choice of heroes includes Paul McCartney. He'll be talking about his plans for the future and performing not one, but two numbers from his latest album. If your weak point is heroes of stage and screen, then I can offer you Charlton Heston. Even louder. He's the star of the Hollywood epic and the Cobies, and he's now about to be Long John Silver. Whether either of them would care to play the roles of my first guests is quite another matter. 8 weeks ago, eight men set out from the northernmost point of Canada to walk 500 miles to the North Pole. They were all members of Ice Walk, an expedition designed to focus world attention on the poisoning of the planet. At times, it was so cold that a glass of water thrown in the air would have frozen before it hit the ground. They faced frostbite, flu, and lack of food. 5 days ago, they finally reached the North Pole, where they raised the flag of the United Nations. This morning, they made it to London, where one more challenge awaited them, meeting Mrs. Thatcher at Downing Street. Tonight, they're here. Please give a warm welcome to three very brave men from the Soviet Union, Misha Malakov, from the United States, Darryl Roberts, and from Britain, the expedition leader, Robert Swan. You made it.
We did.
Not just here, but there. Was there a moment ever when you thought you wouldn't make it?
No, there wasn't. But I wanted us all to make it, and in time too, because we had a lot of problems on the way.
What, the frostbite?
Frostbite, the ice breaking up all round us, because the North Pole's like a frozen ocean. A lot of problems on the journey, but we came through.
And the ice became quite thin at some points, didn't it?
It did, yes. No one actually took a bath, although we might have needed one. It was a whole massive set of problems we had to face, each one thin ice, big pressure ridges up in the air, minus 46 degrees Celsius.
And the wind, chilling cold wind.
Well, you can see on our faces there's a bit of damage here and there, but we seem to be improving.
It shows best, of course, on Darryl's face. Look, he's got little white marks around his nose and on his cheeks there. Is that frostbite?
Yes, it was frostbite.
But it was your feet that got it worse. I won't ask to see your feet, but...
Thank you.
I gather the feet went green.
Well, yeah, the skin on the toes died and it changed colour. Quite a variety of colours, actually. They're all right now. 1 month into the journey, they started to heal really quite well.
But was there a moment when the pain was so horrendous you thought you wouldn't make it?
Not from the frostbite, but from the heel that got compounded blisters, which Dr. Malakov really attentively took care of throughout the journey, the entire journey.
This is the expedition doctor sitting in the middle, Misha. You treated everybody for a bit of everything, I gather, on the way. Lots of different ailments they came to you with.
It was very difficult travel, and we had many problems with our health. And as I expect, first it's frostbitten. And the second, small injury. But after this words, I feel my friend Darryl Roberts will not be agree with me, because his blisters was the biggest as I have seen before in my life as a doctor.
Really? You thought he might not make it? He might not be able to reach the pole?
He reached it.
He did reach it. Absolutely. What about, tell me, Robert, reading your reports that you sent back to the Times each week, you said that you all began to dread something imposed on you by the good doctor. This was the group morning pee.
Yes, this is a nasty business. Yes, the doctor is, as you can see, quite severe. He was like the headmaster at school. And as you can see, he's already had blood taken out of us today as well. It's all a question of science, scientific programs, but he insisted that on the morning of the scientific program that we all have a pee at the same time. Now, believe you me, having a pee at minus 45 has got to be done quickly.
easier if you're a man, perhaps.
Well, yes, I mean, you know, it very much so, but the
activity... But why did you have to do it together? I don't extend this subject.
Well, because it had to be done together because then he knew that we'd all had a pee-pee, as he says, at the same time, so he then could monitor the rest of the operation, something to do with it. Morning, pee-pee doctor.
We won't go on with this. What about food, Misha? Who cooked?
Very interesting question. In the end of our day, we usually speak. Go to the buckwheat waiting for us. Because for us, buckwheat was really good food. But now, Robert, I can say honest for all people, our food was disgusting. And if you want to try our food, I don't advise you to do it.
But the odd bar of chocolate, too, to keep you going when the plane came in with supplies.
Yeah, we had some good chocolate bars made up special.
But tell me, Robert, there were times I thought, reading your reports, that it was almost... It sounds ridiculous, but a romantic place to be. You talked about the full moon and the wide, milky skies. Did you feel romantic?
Well, romance is a difficult word. I think that one felt absorbed by the place. And it is, you have to have something to keep you going. And the romance, I suppose, of it was that one was heading home. And to come home, which I have today, Misha's going home tomorrow, Darryl's going home tomorrow, to come home is what it's all about, because that's what you dream of. And I think the romance of the area, it is beautiful, but it is hard. It wants you dead, and if you don't think about it, it will kill you.
But beautiful, beautiful sunsets. Look at
yes,
this
absolutely wonderful. It is a privilege to go to such a place. I might point out that I have now hung up my thermals. I won't be doing any more of this polar exploration business.
You've had enough.
Yes.
What about you, Darryl? Was there a moment when you felt naked fear?
Yeah, there were a few moments during some of the crossings of open water where we had to cross very thin ice, and the doctor leading us through some very difficult situations. I thought of a couple times where I might actually go through because of my feet, I was always stumbling. I thought I might break through the ice.
Falling over the lumps of ice, terrifying. But what you've brought back, gentlemen, is proof, is it not, of the environmental problems that the world faces?
Yes, I mean, one can't prove everything on a lightweight expedition like ours, but we did run a scientific program, and our scientific program, the main thing was really to get some results, to keep people interested in these things that we're now talking about, like...
But the most shocking thing you talk about is this Arctic haze. I mean, we imagine it to be clear and beautiful with wonderful sunsets like that, not to have a kind of industrial haze hanging
around. Well, that was very depressing. I mean, it is literally like you look out onto this beautiful whiteness and there is like smog. You can see it like a layer that you often see above a city in the morning when the clouds are holding it down here in Britain or any industrial place.
And that is our fault?
That is our fault. We are dumping that garbage on the Arctic Ocean from Europe and from... the United States.
And the snow too, Misha, I gather, can be dirty, black, with pollution.
If honest, when we crossed Arctic Ocean, we haven't seen a track of pollution because very, very white snow, very, very blue ice. But analysis, it's good.
The analysis will show that there is.
That there is stuff in there, pesticides, all sorts of
things.
Yeah,
and that's really what we wanted to do. What we wanted to do as a team of seven different countries, and Rupert Summerson from Britain was with us, and Graham Joy from Australia, and Arvid from America.
There they are, sitting on our front row.
Looking very awake. Oh,
the two members of the team, you're all a bit jet-lagged,
yeah,
too.
We're jet-lagged, I mean, we haven't been to sleep for 5 days, but we're hoping.
Zone-lagged.
Yeah. The twilight zone.
But is this what you said to Mrs. Thatcher this morning? Darryl, you met our Prime Minister this morning, didn't you?
Yes,
and did you tell her all about all of this environmental pollution?
Yes, well, we did speak a bit about the environmental pollution and encouraging students, kids, to take action toward and responsibility toward keeping the planet they're going to inherit clean.
Can you just answer me one last question? What does the compass do when you get to the North Pole?
Well, the compass, when we get to the North Pole, in theory, is meant to go round and round, but it doesn't. One has to locate the pole through sort of like an Argos system, which comes up on a tiny little machine and tells us where we are. There's nothing there. It doesn't look any different than the last 56 days, but...
But you don't stand there with this little thing going round and round in the middle of your hand.
No, it doesn't actually happen.
What a shame.
Your mind does, though.
I guess. Gentlemen, congratulations yet again. Thank you very much for coming and talking to us. Sleep well.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Outfield team. And the front row, too. Thank you very much indeed. Well, Charlton Heston and Paul McCartney to come, established talents both, but from time to time on Wogan, it's also good to try and spot the stars of the future. This time, she said, sticking her neck out, I think we've done it. They're three lads from the East End of London. They may call themselves the Outfield, but they're our tip for the top. Here they are with Voices of Babylon. Words and music from Paul McCartney. But first, First, the other man you love tonight, an actor who, to use his own words, has portrayed cardinals and cowboys, kings and quarterbacks, presidents and painters, cops and conmen. We know him as John the Baptist, El Cid, Ben-Hur, Moses, Henry VIII, Mark Antony, Macbeth, Julius Caesar, Michelangelo, and now it's to be Long John Silver. Ladies and gentlemen, will you please welcome, with two legs and no parrot, Charlton Heston.
A lot of cousins out there.
It's ever so difficult for me to know what to call you. I mean, I want to say Mr. Heston. I'm told I should call you Chuck.
Chuck, yeah. Chuck is a nickname they don't use in England, isn't it?
No, they don't. Yeah. Well, I think they do for Charlie, actually.
Charlie, my wife's the only one that gets to call me Charlie.
Do you feel you're being reprimanded if people call you Charlton?
No, my mother calls me Charlton. Mr. DeMille used to call me Charlton, but nobody else does anymore.
Cecil B. called you Charlton.
Yes, indeed.
I must ask you, first of all, about the leg.
We're cutting it off. I'm putting it off as long as I can, you understand.
The amputation occurs next week.
Think what I gave up to play Moses.
Think about it. What about the accent? I mean, you know, comedians run around this country saying, ha ha, Jimmy.
The West Country accent is common to seamen in the 16th, 17th, and 18th century, and is, in fact, the basis of the American accent, because those are the people that went there. I worked very hard on it with Bob Easton, the genius extraordinaire, the only one in the world that can do this, and he does it for everybody. He's done about 6-7 different accents for me, and now he's taught me a West Country accent.
So you got there?
Yes.
Terrific. Who else is in it?
Jim is Christian Bale, who was in Spielberg's Empire of the Sun, played the boy.
The boy.
I think he's going to be very good.
Jim
Oliver
Hawkins.
Reed is Billy Bones. And Christopher Lee, and a marvelous Billy Bones he is, I must say. And Christopher Lee is Blind Pew.
Oh, terrific.
Richard Johnson, who was Norfolk with us last year when we made Man for All Seasons, is Squire Trelawney. And Julian Glover, who's the heavy in Spielberg's last Indiana Jones, is Dr. Livesey.
And your son is the producer and director.
And writer.
And writer.
Yes.
Now, this is the son whom you nearly lost in the bulrushes when you were Moses, is that right?
Well, his mother fell. Yeah, that's true. When he was 3 months old, he played the infant Moses. He quickly realized the limitations of an acting career and retired.
Before
and
he went off
the rest of his time behind the camera.
Before he went off down the river in the little basket.
Yes, exactly. Yes.
I'm sure you do know, it's 33 years since you made the Ten Commandments.
Indeed.
We have a clip of it.
Do you
because
indeed?
We thought we'd love to see it a bit, and it's the bit where you do the very famous trick of all, parting the Red Sea.
Oh, that's, yeah, I can still do it.
Will the fire hold fair or back?
Will it hold?
After that day,
you shall see his chariots no more.
No! You'll be dead under them.
The Lord of hosts will do battle for us. Behold his mighty hand.
Stunt. The whole film was full of them, wasn't it? The
you did notice it. What nice weather you've had these last few days in London. Glad to do it.
But these stunts you don't do. Some stunts you do. You actually rode
the chariot race.
You
yes.
drove the chariot race.
But I knew I was going to win.
It was all fixed.
A fixed race, yeah.
But, I mean, you are of the old school of actor who believes he should do his own stunts.
Oh, no, you can't do stunts. You should learn to do whatever you're supposed to be doing as well as you can do it. and then you listen to the second unit director and the stunt coordinator, and if they say you can do it, you do it. If they don't say you can't do it, don't do it. It's an actor who says he does all his own stunts is either a liar or an idiot. Probably both.
But in Planet of the Apes, I mean, every day...
I just had people hitting at me and whipping me and fire-hosing me and dragging me around by the heels, but there was no stunt involved, just endurance, pain.
You once wrote in your journals that you thought it was a very strange thing for a grown man to spend his professional life pretending to be other people.
Well, that wasn't the way I thought of it. I think that's the way the great world at large thinks of it. It is an odd thing to do, pretending to be other people your whole life. But I found it a marvelously exciting undertaking all the same.
And you've been from the big screen like that, as we've seen, to the stage, your Sir Thomas More and many other parts, and to the small screen, to Jason Colby. Now, many people were surprised you took that part.
I found series television a very interesting challenge. It's film, of course. You do it the same way, you just do it faster. And I found it... especially since I had a considerable amount of creative leverage over how it was done. And it was a rewarding two seasons.
Does that mean the pay was good?
That too. It was rewarding. Certainly that was true. But
so you have no regrets about being Jason at all?
None whatever. When they canceled the show, so the journalist said, "Oh, you must feel terribly abashed." I said, "This is the longest job I've had since the Air Force in World War II. I said, actors get fired all the time.
Tell me something, because, I mean, you're a big man, as we all know. I read that you always go to bed with a gun.
I have a gun by my bedside, yes. Fortunately, we live in a country where the Bill of Rights of our Constitution permits that.
Indeed. I thought it was against the law in California.
No. Mm-mm.
But why do you do that? You feel sufficiently threatened?
I was raised in hunting country. I've always owned guns and used them. That was... service automatic I brought back from the war, and I'm comfortable with it there.
It gives you a feeling of security. Tell me finally, because I know that you have been very exercised over what's been happening in London to the remains of the Shakespearean theatre, the Rose Theatre.
Yes, indeed. I was down there this morning. It was very exciting. I brought even more of the T-shirt they gave me. The Globe T-shirt. See? How about that? Ta-da!
Terrific. Get the Globe on the road. Terrific.
But the Globe is in good shape. The Rose has just been rediscovered. It is the seed ground, not just of Western culture, but of world culture. The plays that were written and performed on that stage dominate the theater in the world, in every country, since then. And it must be and will be preserved. I'm sure it will.
It looks as if that might just happen.
I'm sure it will.
I
brought you a rose to symbolize the Rose Theater.
I see. Oh, wonderful.
I've been carrying it around all day, so it's a little wilted, but so is the rose in its current state.
Keep but you are certainly not. Yeah. Ladies and gentlemen.
Show it to Paul McCartney. He might be interested.
I shall. Thank you very much indeed. Ladies and gentlemen, Charlton Heston. Finally, pop stars come and pop stars go, and sometimes it's blink and you miss them. But occasionally, a musician appears whose dedication to excellence allows him to span the generations. I hope I'm not making him sound too old, because I'm not very much younger myself. I was a fan. I am a fan of Paul McCartney. Because I just want to talk to him just for a couple of minutes.
Right.
It's a new band. Is this it?
Is this the new band? This is the new band, Sue.
This is the new band?
Band, Sue. Sue, band.
Hello, band. Hello, band. Is this the band that's going on a big tour?
Yes, this is. This is the same band, unless we sack them all in the meantime.
But you're
this
not thinking
very
doing
possible.
That.
No, just kidding.
And when are you going on this tour?
In September.
Of the world?
September of the world, yes. Oh, we have a laugh on this show, don't
we?
I know, I'm just kidding.
Listen, it can't be for the money, it can't be for the fame, it must be because you adore music.
It is, yes. I do like doing it.
Just a little?
Yeah, well, I do. I love it. It keeps me off the streets.
And some new songs you've been writing with Elvis Costello.
Yes, that's right. On the new album, which is called Flowers in the Dirt. Plug, plug. And
why not?
There's about four of them with Elvis.
How do you write the songs with Elvis? What do you actually do?
Little pencil. You get a little pencil.
I knew it was going to be like this.
No,
I could tell.
No,
come on,
no,
you sit down.
Great.
You sit down with the guitar.
We sat down with two acoustic guitars, kind of across from each other, and just started making up things. And then I'd sort of say, well, I don't like that, or he'd say he didn't like that. We'd just edit each other, and he's good at writing songs, and you know, so we kind of got on like two craftsmen kind of thing. It was good fun.
I heard you say somewhere that it was the nearest you'd come to writing with John Lennon. That it's a similar kind of partnership.
Yeah, he reminded me of John a little bit. I think mainly, main thing is like the idea that he's got a kind of strong exterior and a kind of warm interior, which sort of John had. But he takes no messing around and stuff, you know, but it were grand.
So you come along with a kind of nice line and he puts in the acid wit.
Well, I think so, yeah. It was a bit like that, you know, obviously not really like John, but... probably the most I've worked like John than with anybody else in the world.
All right, we're settled for that. It has to be said, and they'll find out in a minute, but there's a distinct 60s Beatle-ish sound about it, huh?
But not the whole album, but just some of the tracks, yeah. I think Elvis kind of led me a little bit towards that because he's a fan of the kind of 60s stuff, you know.
Mm. So you're off on tour, which must be... I don't understand why you want to do it. I mean, we're talking about hell on earth, walking to the Arctic, but, I mean, it must be hell. Packing, unpacking for 12 months.
It is hell, Sue. It's not easy at the top. It's a tough life. In fact, I think we ought to cancel the tour right here and now. No.
Don't do that. I shall go away, because you obviously want to play. You don't want to talk to me at all, do you?
Can
like
we?
To tell?
No, I do.
I'm going away while you play what I've been calling all afternoon Pieces of Eight.
Pieces of Eight. As bad as me.
I know, because of the parrot and all that. It's called Figure of Eight.
Figure of Eight, yeah.
And then after that, we're going to have the latest single, which is My Brave Face.
My Brave Face.
Did I get that right?
Yes, that's okay. Right.
Right, we've got some dancers, especially for you. Shall we have the dancers on stage? And shall I leave you to...
Yeah, I'll be And welcome to Crackerjack. Crackerjack. We'd like to do a song off a new album, what is called My Brave Face. One, two, three, four.
My brave, my brave, my brave face. I've been living in style, unaccustomed.
Table. I'm late.
Thank you. Thank you, folks. Thank you, Stu.
Promotions. One is for James Payne's Florist of Hastings, who provided tonight's lovely floral creations. They'll be exhibiting at the Chelsea Flower Show next week, this one courtesy of Charlton Heston, of course. The other shameless promotion is for myself. I'll be back next week when my guests will include Thora Heard, Julie Walters, Cliff Richard and Jason Donovan. Don't miss a moment of it. I'm being sent up again. Good night.